This is Lockbox Files. At the tone, leave your name and message, and we'll get back to you.
You are full of bullshit, my friend. I will sue you for everything you have. I will sue your ass.
To Lockbox Files episode 2. Yeah, we're having an episode 2 because guess what? The Elachi Lockbox has come out. Who's excited?
Me.
Pumping old man's fist in the air. Yay.
There we go. I hear you guys are quite pumped for this Lockbox. So
best Lockbox ever.
Yeah, I'm going to have to agree with you there. That's my sarcasm, boys. I actually do not care for this Lockbox. I know, right? Okay, so I'm Admiral Murphy. Hi. And here we've got Tanar.
Hello.
Amuro.
Hello.
Chunter.
Yep.
Dustmop.
Howdy, howdy.
Hershey.
Hello.
Mystic, possibly.
Hi.
Ether.
Hi.
Mike.
Yes.
And Spud.
Greetings and salutations.
So I think we've beaten the world record for the biggest podcast now, at least for Stowe. So everybody can give themselves a pat on the back right now for that. I think we even beat episode 1. Yeah, so we're going to have a lot of different opinions here because, come on, the lockboxes are such a huge thing in this game now. So we'll have hopefully a very good discussion here about this lockbox. But first, let's get started. The Elachi Lockbox. What's all in it? So let's see. I looked at this lockbox right off the bat and found I didn't really care for anything in it. I don't know if I should feel bad about that. Does anybody else care? Anybody have something in the box that they really care about before we kind of go through it?
I'm going to jump in and say I care about this box. I really did like it. I thought it was a little bit of a change up from the old ones. I liked the consoles that came with it. I liked the ships. I like the other pets that you got with it, the consumables, and I'm not saying that because I got the ship.
Yeah, a spoiler for the future of the recording.
We open boxes.
Whilst I like the console that's in this lockbox, I don't like the way it's implemented because every other console up to now has been in a C-store ship.
Yeah, let's discuss the console in a bit because that's something I think we have a lot of opinions on. But I looked at this lockbox and I went, because usually when I look at a lockbox, I don't just look at the ship because I know I'm never getting the ship unless I buy it through other means. So I just disregarding that, I didn't even think the ship was that cool. But, excuse me, the only thing I thought was kind of cool was the plasma drone that walks around. That looked kind of cool.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know, anybody else like that?
You felt it tonight in our PvP match. Chased Shannis all around and killed him all the time.
Yeah, that was mine then.
The crescent weapons aren't that bad looking. I don't need them, but they were always cool to go up against, because, hey,
yeah, but
that's something way different.
The problem is the proc.
What is it?
What is it?
Seems they are not proccing as intended.
So what's the proc supposed to do, though?
It's
penetrate your shields.
Yeah, it's a 2.5% chance to ignore the target shields completely, and 50% of the target's damage resistance.
What did you hear about that, Hershey?
Stow forums.
The source for all wisdom. But so the first ship that we've got here is the Elachi Sigloth Escort, which Tanar, you will actually, people, a spoiler alert, Tanar got it. He got it during our lockbox opening.
I got it.
Yes, we hate him.
So I guess we'll be seeing you around, flying around in that maybe, or
you
plan to sell it?
No, I'm actually keeping this. This is the first one I'm actually going to keep.
Anybody know what this is going for right now? That's in-game?
68 million.
I sold one yesterday for 66 million.
Alright, so about average. Seems a little bit less than some of the other ones, though.
Yeah, it seems that the rate of dropping is up. Yep.
I noticed that. I saw quite a few more because usually they have multiple big ships, right? This is the only big ship for the lockbox, right?
I bought mine on launch day and I paid 86 million for it.
Mm. And see, that's what surprised me was the fact that it was so low on launch. Usually you're looking at the 100 million when it first goes on. And then by the weekend, you're looking at maybe about 90. About a week later, you're looking at the 80s, low 70s.
Yep.
Now, is that due to the fact that it's not a popular lockbox or it's really popular on Sunny Creek? Boxes have been opened.
I think it's really popular because of that. The price is lower than usual.
I don't know, because I want to go unpopular. Are the Elachi popular?
Yeah, I don't know.
Because like the Cardassian box, the Galor class was always in the show, so I could see why people would want to fly that. Same with like so many of the other ships. This one was in like one episode, really great.
Right, right.
And it's not that great of an episode.
I would have to say, based on exposure, we haven't really been exposed to the Elachi. We really don't know who they are. We don't know what purpose they serve. Either in this game or in the Stowe universe, and so that could be it.
Well, the answer is pretty simple here. You should look at the stats of the ships.
Yep, we do have a ship stats segment coming up with Riri again, so you'll get to hear his thoughts on the ship. But Hershey, what are you thinking about the ship?
Well, the Elachi Escort is a wannabe Zemhadar bug ship.
Oh, so it doesn't live up?
Almost. It has the best shield modifier of an escort, and it's so much survivable than the bug ship in game, but it lacks firepower. And the battleship, wow, that's exact replica of Fleet Thorket.
Go ahead.
Exact replica of the Fleet Warcher. Almost exact. So, two great ships in one lockbox. Never happened before.
If I could just chime in on the escort ship. However, whilst it does have the highest shield modifier on it in pretty much any escort in the game, it's also got one of the lowest hull ratings to cover that.
Yeah, and they need to compensate.
Yeah, but it goes a bit further than that, because as you've said, it's lacking a little bit of firepower. Looking at the stats, I believe that's mostly down to the buff layout, which mirrors the Prometheus quite closely. Yep. Having flown the Prometheus myself and noticed its own shortcomings, I feel that those are going to be exacerbated in this Sigoth Escort as time goes on.
One suggestion then, open that Escort on your Engineer.
That would be the only one.
Yeah, you'll never die.
So what do you guys thinking of the Crescent Wave cannon here? It feels like that's going to be like the Thaleron cannon. Dude, turn off your voice mod. I can't even understand you, man. So anybody flown the ship here yet? Or is
which
just
one?
Yep. We're still in the escort here.
Yep, I bought it.
So what are you thinking of the Wave cannon? The Crescent Wave cannon that comes with the escort?
I didn't bought the console yet. The universal console.
I have them all. Love it.
You like it?
Yeah, people are whinging and complaining that it's not powerful enough, but the whole set bonuses, I quite like it. Comes with a hazard system, and the sort of the character's got it. I can't remember what it is.
Crescent Wave can, but the drawback is you are completely disabled when you fire. Yep. You can't move.
Yep, you can't. I noticed that earlier in the PvP match, where you can't even use a tractor beam.
Yep.
Right, there is the Crescent Wave cannon. There is. It's only a single cannon.
Yep.
But it has under negative lead targeting now. It's not too bad. And then the complete bonus gives you subspace disruption and then haywire. Don't know much about the subspace disruptions, but the haywire you see in space is these three glowy lights circling the ship. It's pretty cool.
So then we've got the battleship from the Lobby store. Anybody get this one yet?
Yep, I love it. It's essentially, like I said, the Fleet Orchid on the Fed. You can open it on the Fed. And it's durable in combat, has firepower. The console is useless, but okay.
So what is the console for this ship?
How is it called?
It says here, subspace transceiver, I believe?
Yeah, you launch a small support craft from the vessel.
Oh, okay, so like the ones you fight in the game.
Yeah, it's useless. Don't put it on.
It's the Mombosh support craft and the Mombosh control craft. Now, the support craft is there, it's a healer pet. Whereas the control one, it's more your crowd control abilities, like the gravity well and viral matrix.
Yeah, I've got them both equipped. I've no idea how to swap between the two. There's no way of choosing one set of pet or the other set of pet.
No, it brings in one of each.
Okay, I'll get to see that.
It launches two small support crafts.
No, I've seen two, but I've only ever seen two that do healing or two that do attacking.
When we were testing this the other day, just after you got them, you fired it off, and both types of craft did come in. Because this is one of them you wouldn't see doing much, because it doesn't have anything that shows off, and to be honest, it didn't survive very long.
Yeah, another shiny.
Because it's a console, you all already have a bunch of universal consoles, this one is pretty useless.
Alright. So yeah, those are the two main ships, of course, and there's a bunch of mirror ships and for both Fed, KEF, and Romulan. I'll let Wee, he probably goes into them in his audio recording, so we'll skip those for now. But we talked about the ground stuff already. Should we hit traits before we get on our rant about the new console?
Yeah, we could.
Yeah, the console could be a pretty long one.
Yep. So let's hit the traits real quick. So I'm not a big trait guy, but does anybody else here want to hit the traits real quick? What they think?
I've picked up two of the traits, and one of them, it's really solely there for carrier pilots. It's plus 100% boost to the.
Yep, I see here wing commander space operate. Traits.
Yes, that's yep. it. That's the one. That one I could have found a use for. But it's a trade slot, then it's too situational for me, so I wouldn't just stole this right away.
So yeah, unless you're flying somebody in a carrier, this one is not probably going to be for you.
The other one I picked up, which I am keeping because I think it's going to be invaluable, it's the genetic resequencer ground trait regenerative tissue.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
I see that one here.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that is... I think the best trait in this lockbox.
Unfortunately, I don't have the information on it to hand. But
plus 22 all damage resistance rating versus damage over times, plus 25 healing received, and plus 0.1 health regeneration. So you put it on your side and you're good to go.
Yeah, you can put it on your science, you're good to go. Put it on a tactical and open. Fight off some of the shortcomings, or stick it on your engineer and make it nigh on impenetrable, especially if you use a bunker fabrication kit.
The firearm specialist one I like here for the quick cooldown, it says, for your secondary attacks every once in a while. That's going to be nice for snipers.
It seems that trait is not working either.
Oh, another one. That's great.
Yep.
Because that one got my eye. I was like really excited for something. Like, ooh, I hate it.
Not working, but... they'll probably fix it.
Hopefully soon. And then the other one here is Inspirational Leader. Let's see, that gives you a 10% chance activating any bridge officer ability, grants plus 10 to all starship skills for 15 seconds. May stack up to 3 times.
Would be interesting, but didn't test it, so...
yeah, it's not jumping out to me super much, but definitely the regenerative tissue definitely seems like a good one for keeping yourself alive.
Oh, yeah.
I think that's it. I mean, we hit the ground toys. I mean, of course, all the standard stuff that's been in the other ones.
Let's go with ground consumables.
Is it the same as the last box? I know we've got the plasma drone. What else do we got?
Much better. Elachi flame crawler.
That's the one thing that looked really cool.
The flame thrower is awesome. Awesome. I love it.
Yes. It's basically like that plasma turret you get for the Romulan, right?
But it's chasing you all around the map.
Yeah.
Yeah. The other one, it's the crit. Is again, it's another crescent wave thing, but it's the, I think it's a like a cannon turret.
Blast turret.
Yeah.
Yeah. So with your engineer proc on your turret, then add blast turret or flame crawler. Wow. Yeah. Most kills, most definitely.
I'm pretty sad the skitterer companion is a non-combat pet. I know we boned.
I'm gonna side with Wheelie on this one. If that thing was made of combat pit, I would actually log out, uninstall, and walk away, because that's just taking things too far.
Awesome.
It is awesome, and I'm gonna disagree with you, Amaro. I think it should have been a combat pet, and I think they could have dumbed it down enough where it just had a knockback with, you know, some damage.
I wanna throw that thing at Wheelie and piss him off. I'm just saying, that's why I want that thing.
You mean at his face?
Hell yeah. Hey, Wee-Wee, catch!
That's an idea I can get behind.
But yeah, anyway, that's all the stuff. But we did pass over, of course, the highly debated console, especially now after we just did a PvP event with this console in it. What is the name of it? I'm trying to find it in this big long doc.
It's the Subspace Integration Circuit.
And that comes with which one? That's just a console that comes out of it, right?
Yes, that's a standalone console. It's completely on its own. It's taking the place of what would normally be a cross-faction console in the Lockbox.
So what is this console supposed to do?
What it does is it fires a pulse of energy towards your target, and on contact, this pulse of energy just explodes into a 3-kilometer radius blackened hole in subspace. Any enemy ship caught within this radius is in essence completely disabled. No abilities available with the exception of tactical team, engineering team, and science team. A 99% debuff on base perception. Your engines are taken offline, and you're pretty much left to die.
So I'm already gonna claim OP for this thing. I never really do it, but for this, I'm claiming OP. Because I've been like one shot killed in space because of this.
One note, it seems they're listening to feedback on this console and they're changing it soon.
Yeah, because definitely there's something wrong with it.
None of my teams were active. They were grayed out as well.
Mine too. Everything was shut down.
Everything was shut down for me as well.
In the event tonight, I was hit by it on three separate occasions. On all three, I was able to activate all three of my teams.
I was hit at least 6 or 7 times. Every time everything was shut down.
Wasn't able to activate a single ability.
Tactical team and engineering team, and they were always grayed out.
The other problem I have with this is it really throws you off when your entire screen goes black. And there were several cases where it just wouldn't go black, but it would like flicker, so it would like confuse you at first, like there was a graphical bug or something. I had that several times during the PvP match, and it really just throws you off.
I got hit with it twice, and my entire power bar went gray, but I was still able to move, if only at a snail's pace.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. With the screen flicker, I actually thought there was something wrong with my graphics card.
Same. I first, when I noticed it, I was like, was that just a bug? And then I was like, oh no, that's a new console. And I was like, oh, well that's fun.
AKA black hole.
The closest way to actually describe it is fluidic, is it's like being caught in a bubble in fluidic space. I can't remember the mission and the Undine storyline, but you can fly through these black areas in fluidic space, and it's essentially like being stuck in one of those, only your main engines are offline, you're left. Mm-hmm. If you're lucky, you've got thrusters, because that's the little bit of motion that you've got left over, is the thrusters backup that you get in some of the engines. It's not your main impulse at all.
I find it hilarious, though, that they've introduced this, which is basically, would you guys compare this to, like, the Breen torpedo from the show, where it just disables your ship completely?
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
So I find that absolutely hilarious, because for those of you who are at the launch of the game, I think it was, like, Subnuke or Viral Matrix. That basically did the same thing, and they eventually had to change it because so many people got pissed off that everything was practically disabled, whereas now in game, I believe, it's where it shuts off, like, one system at a time instead of all of them at once.
I'd equate it to leaving a packlet in the breaker room of your ship.
Or Bajoran. Yeah, Bajoran.
Yeah. Yeah, it's the Bajorans. It's actually, this console's actually putting Bajorans on your ship now. It's not doing this whole black hole thing, it's just Bajorans on the ship. But, yeah, it seems like some other lockboxes before this have had a more cooler variety of things, heck, a bigger variety, but...
I have to disagree on that.
What is your opinion? That's, because that is mine.
I think the best lockbox, I got almost all the items in it. The best ships, no doubt. The best consumables. Traits. Okay, traits were good. The best console ever. What else would you do?
I don't like the idea that the console's in a lockbox.
That's another
console's
thing.
Been attached to a ship, so you can buy it or grind up the dilithium. Now you're forced to open a lockbox to get it.
Yeah, but
are these things able to be sold on the exchange?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, it's at least they can do
million,
that.
Million EC for this console.
I'm completely agreeing with Chanter on this one, because it is a worrying precedent that's being set here.
It worried me too, because I don't know if we've mentioned this in the last episode, but one thing I'm really against them putting in the lockboxes is like the Doff missions, because with the temporal lockbox, you have those time missions you could pick up, but only through the lockbox. And I'm somebody who, I loved the Doff system, especially the chains, but ever since I finished those, the system's been pretty much dead for me. I haven't gone back to it. And I was really disheartened to see that new content was coming to the Doff system, but I had to pay for the chance to get it, which seems really dumb.
Yeah, I didn't like that either, especially the ones before that. You had the hologram Doffs, and you collected all of them. Then you got to run that Shakespeare
one.
And I thought, no, that's...
That was a lot of Doffs, too.
Well, they said Doffs is getting an overhaul soon, and they're coming soon next Tuesday, etc., etc.
Yeah, so, I really hope so.
I hope they do step away from this Doff missions in a lockbox.
Yeah, I'm not liking the whole idea of this type of stuff, especially for systems that need updating. I don't think it should be done through lockbox.
Doesn't Doff missions count as content? And if it does, PWE have said they want all content to be free.
And that goes back to the debate of what is content, because people will claim ships are content, and I for one, don't think it is. It's anything you can pretty much play in the game, I'm going to consider as some sort of content.
They said that they think that ships are content, so...
You see, and I've heard other devs where it's like, no, because I think Gecko's even said...
can do. You can't do
They've said both, and that's the problem, is nobody knows what content it is anymore, because we've heard both. I've heard from Cryptic on separate occasions where it's been, oh, the ships are content, and no, they're not. All I know is if I can go play it, it's content. That's what I think it is. And that does, in my opinion, that includes Doff system.
Now, going back to the Doffs real quick, one thing I am happy with, if you are lucky to get a purple Doff in this lockbox, one thing they did was they have what it can do for, like, space. Then at the end, with these, they have the ground plus space increased damage to Elachi. I did like that, because that way I don't have to look, I don't have to slot one for ground, one for space. I could just slot one if I want it, or I like the ability, and it affects both.
Yeah, but the main thing is they crashed the price of several Doffs that were so popular, like for a cannon special ability.
Yep.
It was about 30, 40 million, now it's 5 million.
Yep, I picked up three earlier, 5 million each.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Me too.
As well as another thing, if you're lucky enough to get that survivor pack, it gives you two purples.
Yep. I just want two.
Yeah, so, well, the Elachi Lockbox has come out. What do you guys think is going to be the next lockbox? My vote's Doff.
Both.
Yeah, I think it'll be Voth too.
Yeah, I think it'll be the Voth.
Well, guess what? I can tell you it's all wrong, because I got a secret email about the next lockbox, and we'll be getting into that. But first, let's go into some ship math with WeeWee, and we'll see what he has to say on the ships.
Hello, and welcome to the ship segment of the Lockbox podcast. Now, in the first episode, we covered the Tal Shiar ships, the Tal Shiar Adapted Destroyer and the Tal Shiar Battlecruiser, because that was a new Lockbox. We have another one. It's the Elachi ships. Yes, you get to fly two of the ships that you've been constantly irritated by in those Elachi missions that you have to constantly fight and all that kind of stuff. We have two ships. The Elachi Sagoth Escort, speaks for itself, and the Elachi Mambosh Battleship, which is a battlecruiser. More on that later. The first one, the Elachi Sagoth Escort. It's an escort, so it's tactical. That's all good, isn't it? Well, let's find out. Base hull, we'll compare it to, I'd say about three of the ships that I'd say are about similar. The Temple Destroyers, since they're all exactly the same. The Chelgret from December, and the Fleet Prometheus, the Fleet Advanced Escort from the Fleet System, which has been out for over a year now. Now, the base out of the base hull, it has the lowest one out of them, out of the four, 28,500, which is pretty significantly low actually for an escort. I mean, that's lower than a standard RA escort, which is 30k. So it's like 1,500 lower than that. That's, yeah, it's leaning in, it's science vessel territory, and that would also explain the shield modifier. Which, by the way, is 1.3. The highest base shield modifier of any escort in game. When I say escort, I mean tactical ship. You count like raptors, destroyers, escorts, all that kind of stuff. Tactical warbirds, birds of prey if you wanted to. All that kind of stuff. It's the highest one. That's science vessel territory. The hull and the shield modifier are science vessel territory. But let me emphasize this. It's an escort with those base values from a science ship. Now, this is pretty unique, I have to say. We haven't seen that before. I mean, we've come close, debatably, in the past. But, and we've definitely seen other tactical ships, maybe like the Temporal Destroyer, and definitely the Bug, with like base hulls and shield modifiers equivalent that really to a cruiser. This is a science ship. Now, science ships have a lower base hull, and in return have a higher shield modifier. The Escort is the same, except that you will actually do damage in this thing. Now, standard fore and aft layout, 4 and 3, so you won't get like a 4-4 like the Chalgret, I'll say that right now. 200 crew, kind of irrelevant. Lowest crew, by the way, out of the four ships we're comparing. Now, the buff layout is where it gets interesting. Commander Tactical, of course. Lieutenant Commander Science, like the Chalgret and the Advanced Escort, so not a universal one like the Temple Destroyer. A Lieutenant Universal, like the Temple Destroyer. Another Lieutenant Universal, so two, so pretty versatile on that front, whereas all of the others have a Lieutenant Tactical somewhere, and an Ensign Engineering like the Temporal Destroyer. Now, the buff layout is, I'd say it's a combination, but about 60% of it is about the same as the Temporal Destroyer, whereas about the other, like, 40% of it is what you would expect, really, or like the other ships. So generally, I'd say the buff layout, I'd expect something you would put on a Temporal Destroyer, and maybe a couple of those could work on here, but it would be a different combination. You would put probably same buff layouts if you wanted to, and all that kind of stuff. But in this case, you would probably want to like experiment with the versatility of the two Lieutenant Universals if you wanted to. That gives this ship an advantage. The versatility of it from buff layout point of view is pretty significant, so I'd try and experiment with that if you want to. Especially the Ensign Engineering, which can be pretty useful for survivability as well. Two device slots, one less than the Chalgret, so pretty standard stuff as well. Console layout, it's the same as the Temporal Destroyer, again. Four tactical and four science with two engineering. So a lot of field generators is probably a potential here. Base turn rate is 16. Which is the same as a Fleet Prometheus, and one higher than the Temple Destroyer. The impulse modifier and the inertia rate, the same as a standard escort, 0.2 and 70 respectively, so you expect this thing to move like a standard escort, turn rate and actual movement-wise, anywhere. So don't expect to like drift off like a Volkoop or something. Bonus power levels, plus 10 to weapons and plus 5 to engines, so you have a bit of engine power to help boost your turn rate, and of course the standard like boost to weapons and boost to damage, as you would expect an escort. That general power layout is generally the same as a destroyer or most of the tactical warbirds you see on the Romulan side. Other than that, it's got the Crescent Wave Cannon, which I will leave up to you guys whether you find that useful or not. But generally, I have to say there's a Golf Escort. I almost call it a middle ground between the Temple Destroyer, the Chalgret, and the Advanced Escort. But if I really had to say which ship it was the most like, I would pick the Temple Destroyer, actually. Because out of all of the stuff I've said so far, Temple Destroyer is probably cropped up most often out of the ships that we've said so far. I mean, it's got a few like bits and pieces, say from like the Prometheus, like the same turn rate, like the same Lieutenant Commander slot, all that kind of stuff, as you would expect. But the Temple Destroyer is a lot like this in very, very similar ways. The Chalgret isn't really like this at all, but it's on the list because, well, it's a Lieutenant Commander science as well. It's a science crew, it's a science tactical ship. It's almost a cruiser at the same time. So the Golf Escort, like I said, it's a middle ground, but leaning slightly towards the Temple Destroyer, if I really had to say so. Generally, I'd say the ship is pretty versatile, actually. You'd expect quite a bit of customization, at least I would expect that. Quite a good survivability ratio. Based on it 16 and shield modifier 1.3, you have a lot of survivability on the shields while there. So you'll probably want to stack up with more hull heals, if anything. But keep those shield powers there, because the shield modifier is there for a reason. You'll probably want to keep them that high, but make sure you don't like disintegrate over with hull with full shields or something. That's always a bad thing, isn't it? Now, we have another ship. The Elachi Monbosch Battleship, which, as you heard me say earlier at the beginning, is a battlecruiser. Now, the reason I'm saying that is because most of the stats are very similar to the Fleet Torkat Battlecruiser Retrofit. The fleet voucher, in other words, that the Klingons can buy from the fleet system, the Tier 2 Starbase shipyard unlock. Now, I'm going to list the stats here, and I'm going to compare them directly as each one goes to the Torkat. Okay? So base hull, 39k. That's 600 less than the Fleet Torkat, so minimal difference there. Shield modifier 1.2. It's about the same as a Galore. It's kind of expected for like a cruiser of that level, like a Lockbox cruiser. You kind of expect just a high shield modifier, that kind of thing. So quite good for a battle cruiser, actually. Fore and aft weapon slots, of course, because it's a cruiser. More crew, kind of irrelevant. The bow flight, where it gets a little bit different. Same commander and lieutenant commander slots, commander engineering and lieutenant commander tactical. Same lieutenant universal. But like the Sigolf Escort, the Monbosch has another lieutenant universal, whereas the Torkat has a tactical, and the Monbosch replaces the ensign engineering from the Torkat with an ensign science. So you have, again, you have a pretty versatile layout, like the Sigolf Escort, two lieutenant universals, and an ensign science to top it all off, for a bit of those science orientations you kept getting irritated by in those missions. Generally, I'd say this buff layout is pretty versatile, actually. Those you have listed of all three of the professions, of course, with like commander engineering, lieutenant commander tactical. This is clearly meant to be a battlecruiser. I mean, I'll get into why a little bit later as well. But at the same time, you could easily make this into a very powerful cruiser and a very powerful tactical ship. Now, I would always consider a battlecruiser a tactical ship more than an actual cruiser. And this is just in a personal opinion, by the way. It's not like I'm defining opinion or anything. It's because if you think about it, battle cruisers are cruisers with natural survivability, and if you step a tactical in there, you will do a lot of DPS. You can rival DPS of an escort if you set it up correctly, and you can have the survivability of a cruiser at the same time. So imagine doing that in a Monbosch, or more specifically a Fleet Torkat, which is on first. So you would have a Monbosch, which can dual heavies, has near enough an escort DPS, if you can handle the turn rate, that is, which is 10. Let me emphasize that, 10. And you have all the tactical abilities to boost it off as well. Now think about that for a second. Imagine that kind of a ship you would have. You would easily be able to conquer those STFs you want, or if you're a PvPer, you will be pretty significantly good, I'd actually say, in PvP. If you were interested in that sort of thing. But the base turn rate being 10, that is equivalent to a Klingon battlecruiser, hence Fleet Torkat battlecruiser, the Klingon one. Now, the only real ship you see with such a high turn rate would be the Galore, and the Galore is slightly out of it, because generally battlecruisers, other than the board, with the exception of the board task, have a higher base turn rate than the Fed cruisers. And of course, the lockbox ships, being lockbox ships, have about the same as the battle cruisers anyway. Now, this presents a very interesting situation with the Mombot, because it allows you to have a pretty good turn rate, first cruiser especially, with a good tactical orientation, dual heavies, and the potential to do DPS rivaling like an escort, whilst having fantastic survivability. Now, just to emphasize, this is not like, I'm not defining opinion or anything. I'm not saying you should set this up because this is like a strength or a weakness. No, I'm saying that this is a very fundamental strength of any battlecruiser. I've flown battlecruisers on the Canadian side for a while now, and what I've become to see is that this tactical orientation, if you stab a tactical in any one of those battlecruisers, you will dish out some serious DPS, especially in the Fleet Talker, and again in the Mombos, because it's almost bad to say it, but the Mombos is almost a one-to-one copy. I mean, it's even got the same bonus power levels, it's got the same kind of movement, same turn rate, inertia rate as well, and the only real difference besides what we listed is the special, of course. The Talker, of course, having a cloaking device because it's a Klingon ship, and the Mombos, the subspace transceiver console, which, again, it's up to you, like the Skull Escort, it's up to you whether you find the console very useful or not. But the reason I say it's almost a one-to-one copy is because baseful, minimal difference. Shield of Fire, medium, minimalist difference. It depends how you define it. Buff layout, it's more versatile, but you can set it up the same way, pretty much, if you wanted to. Device slot, one more device slot. Wow, you really need that, don't you? Minimal. And the special, can be medium, can be small, can be minimal, can be whatever, if you wanted to, find it useful. There we go. That's. I promise you, the rest of the stats are literally the same as the Talker. Now, I don't know about you, but that's kind of bad, really, if you think about it. I mean, the Skull Escort and the Mombosh, they both have good versatility all round, but the Zagoth has more uniqueness to it. It has more, like, to put it a term in it, more like spike uniqueness, to put it. It's like shield modifier 1.3 with a base hull of 20,500. That's like science vessel base stats on an escort. That's a good combination. It's a unique combination. You could expect some different things. The Mombosh, you wouldn't expect too many differences between this and the Talker. Now, that's a potential problem, because you have two ships that are basically the same, one being slightly better than the other, depending on which way you define it. Now, I personally, I've always liked to count on battlecruisers, so I would vote that all the time. The Mombosh, being a lockbox ship, would probably be generally received as a slightly better, because versatility, lockbox ship, what have you. More device slots, whatever you're going to say. So, generally, I'd say the Mombosh is a letdown. It's essentially the same ship as a Talker, which everyone can fly. And I can see that annoying people just because it's like that. Now, I don't know about you, but I would prefer something more versatile and unique for lockbox ships, more specifically in this case, Lobby ships, because most of the ships we've seen so far are pretty generally unique. Really, I mean, there isn't really a lockbox ship out there which is really similar to currently existing ships. I mean, they all have their own unique taste to them. It's like the Bug ship has such a high turn rate, the Recluse has such versatility, the Breen ship is a good all-round ship, whichever profession you fly it in. And the Mombosh, I'll say no more. It's up to you. If you want to try the Mombosh because you like the Talker, or you want to try the Mombosh because you think it's the best tactical cruiser in the game, go right ahead. But when I say the Talker is a fantastic ship, that would therefore mean the Elachi Mombosh battleship is a fantastic ship as well. And I haven't even flown it yet. Now, good luck with that, to be honest. I hope you actually do. I hope you guys do some pretty good builds on the Mombosh, because if it's essentially the same ship as a ship I really, really like. And the Skull Escort, good luck with that as well. I'm looking forward to seeing some of the builds some of you guys actually build up. I'm looking forward to some of the versatility, the combinations, and some of the survivability techniques that some of you guys take up. So I expect to see you guys in the STFs, and in PvP probably, experimenting with this kind of thing. So, thumbs up.
good luck with them. But if I had to give an overall opinion on the two ships that we have, the Sigolth Escort and the Mombosh Battleship, I would say that both of them are let down. Mombosh more, because it's almost the same as a Talkat. And the Sigolth because it has a lot of similarities to currently existing ships. Again, despite being more of a middle ground. Again, it has combination, it has bits and pieces from different ships, but the point is, that's the problem. In a way, if you think about it. At least in my opinion, because it's just bits and pieces stuck together that happens to be a unique ship, supposedly. It has a good, unique taste to it, more than the Mombosh. So, I wouldn't expect too many differences between these two ships and currently existing ships. So don't like scream like it's too powerful or something. The only real screaming I could really expect to hear would probably be the Sigolth with being like shield modifier or something, or a Mombosh battleship for those people who aren't used to facing fleet Talkats all the time. And well, yeah, there we go. I hope you guys like listened to me earlier and said, well, I just want to go up front and say, this is an opinion, and I'm not telling you how to set up your ship or anything. This is what I think is like a very realistic point of view, and I hope you guys realize this. So I look forward to seeing some of your ships there. I look forward to seeing some of the combinations there, but don't expect too many differences. Don't cry overpowered simply because it's a new ship or anything. But generally, good luck. Yeah, have fun.
Holy crap, you got a lockbox! Open it!
Alright, just like last time, we're going to be opening up some more lockboxes, and a few people have already opened there, so I will let them go first. I believe, Chunter, you already opened some, so let us know. Yep. What did you get?
I opened 12. Right, the first one is 5 Lobi Crystal, and then the Elachi Crescent Weapon. 4 Lobi Doffs, yeah. 4 Lobi's Doffs, 4 Lobi's Doffs, 4 Lobi's, yay, 2006 P. More Doffs, 5 Lobi. Oh, got the Elachi Survivor Officers, might be good ones in there. 5 Lobi. More Doffs, 5 Lobi. 4 Lobi, more Doffs. 4 Lobi, more Doffs. 4 Lobi, and guess what?
Hey!
Weapons, my last one.
Nice. But okay, so how do you Lobi. Feel? Worth the money?
If I'd have put real money into that, I would have been severely bleeped. But since that's ground out dilithium, I'm not too upset.
Anything you're super excited to get? Anything? The Crescent Weapon sounds
good. Out of that, I might get some decent weapons, and hopefully some decent doffs out of the Survivor Pack. Still got my weapons here.
Alright, did anybody else already open up lock boxes that want to go?
I opened up 10 boxes. And I got 2 Crescent Wave weapon packs, 1 ground trait, regenerative tissue. I got a 25,000 fleet credit bonus pool, a 100 fleet mark bonus pool, 1 dilithium mining claim preferred customer pack, 3 reinforcement duty officer mini packs, and 1 purple Elachi survivor officer pack, along with a total of 66 Lobi.
And how are you feeling right now?
Wrapped off.
Can I just jump back in?
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm super happy because I just opened that pack and I got Elachi dual heavy crescent cannons mark 12 accuracy times 3. So now I'm happy. Nice. happy.
Now you're happy. Okay, that's good. At least somebody's happy so far.
Envy, I've just opened up my own crescent wave weapon packs, mark 12 shotgun and a mark 12, a mark 11 dual heavy crescent cannon, and the mods weren't very good on them, so I feel really ripped off now.
All right, who wants to go next and hopefully get a ship?
I would do this.
Alright, go ahead, Ethier.
I opened mine, and I've got to quote, a Fleet Support Duty Officer Mini Pack, a 100 Fleet Mark Bonus Pool, and 11 Lobi. That's
Sorry,
it.
Sorry, Ethier. Got it. Got the ship. Didn't mean to interrupt. Got
Uh-oh.
The ship.
Uh-oh. What'd you get?
Got it. I Which got one? The special ship there. The Elachi Zaka Escort. Yes.
Oh nice. Yeah, just seen the gameplay announcement. Congrats, yay!
Nice, man!
How many boxes did you open to get that?
I want to stab you in the face.
Yeah, how many did you open?
I opened 20.
Is that the only 20 you opened?
Yes.
Do douche.
So, hey, that's a first for Lockbox Files. Somebody actually got the big ship, so nice.
Yeah.
All right, Ethereum, do you have any more?
Can I I only got two boxes over the last few days, right. And I feel very ripped off.
Tanar doesn't feel ripped off, I bet.
No, I don't. It was worth it. Everybody should go out and get some keys.
Yeah.
Give us keys for free sometimes.
Right now, I don't know whether to feel ripped off or not, because I've just gotten my fifth subspace integration circuit.
Jesus.
Anything else did you get, Desmop? What have you gotten so far?
Yeah, I've gotten a pile of the evil console, a pile of survivor officers, and a pile of whatever the heck Elachi Crescent weapons are.
Open it.
Feel free to send one of those consoles my way.
Alright, anybody else?
Me, can I open...
Go ahead.
No.
This is just like Christmas, see. I'm so excited.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Wait, hang on, Hershey. Movie. Wait, Hershey, aren't you on the naughty list?
Oh.
You should be opening presents.
Five lobby and fleet credit bonus pool, 25,000. Oh, 15 lobby and duty officer pack reinforcements. 4 lobby and fleet credit bonus pool again. Fleet support officer pack, 5 lobby. The last one, Mirror Universe Reconnaissance Science Vessel and 4 lobby.
Careful, they all want that one.
And that is it, 28 lobby, 2 support duty officer packs, and two fleet credit bonus pools. That is it.
So we've got Tanar and Chunter here who seem pretty happy about what they've gotten. Everybody else? Anybody else happy?
I'm moderately happy.
Moderately? Okay, and everybody else is kind of meh.
Yeah.
Fleet officer support pack and 4 lobby.
Ooh. 4 lobby. I'm excited.
Ooh. I think 4 lobby is a bit of a too much of a low number, though. You should bump it up.
I do agree. That was my next question I would ask you guys. How are you feeling about the lobby numbers you've gotten so far?
Can you imagine you use real money? That's a dollar. And you're going to get 4 poxy lobby? Nah, not happy with that.
What? Because what? 4 gets you like a hypo or whatever?
You consider you need 800 to get the lobby ship. That's a lot of keys. And if you use real money, that's divorce sort of material.
Oh, that's mop, that's a good trade. Sell it now.
Yeah, right. I just picked up one of those as well, the Wing Commander trait, then another batch of 10.
Yes.
Alright, so that's us opening lockboxes again. And next up, what is this? I think we've got the next lockbox leak. Alright, I've joined back up with Mystic, because we pretty much work like an awesome pair on this show. And so this will be like this week's community feedback, I guess, because we got an ultra super secret message from a developer, I guess, at Cryptic, from a super secret email. All we know is that he calls himself the Lockbox Dev. So I guess he's the guy who makes all the lockboxes. I guess he's super secret position, but anyway.
I would have preferred Deep Throat.
You know what? Yeah, me too. That's what it should have been, but whatever. I'm not here to judge, but I am here to judge the content of this. So he's basically leaked us the next lockbox, and so we're gonna reveal it here on the show. It is the so you all know that Sela's been back for quite a bit. Denise Crosby's been voicing both Tasha Yar and Sela. So I guess the rumor is right now is that during Vegas, they met with her to plan out this next lockbox. As it is, the Tasha Yar lockbox that has been sent to us. And we've got a few of the items that they're planning here. So I guess we'll just hit them. But I guess they like their Denise Crosby so much because they got her in like so many times. So I guess it's like, hey, why don't we get a lockbox in with her? So for all of you who think it's going to be Voth, sorry, it is the Tasha Yar lockbox. We don't have a date on when this is going to come out, but we do have a few of the items, so let's hit it here first. One of the consoles here, it seems, it's going to be called the Enterprise C Maneuver Console for both Fed and KDF. Why even try when the going gets tough? Do the sea and watch your hull hold its own barbecue. It can be equipped on any ship and does not have a cooldown, so it's perfect for PvP. So that's good. I mean,
sounds like a party.
Yeah, I mean, who wants cooldowns on their abilities for PvP? I mean, you just got to sit around and wait. I'm liking this console. This seems kind of cool.
Hell, if you love that, Murphy, you're going to love the Tasha Yar Mark 12 armor. Not only are you the life of the party, this hot armor, when you equip it, you get thrown across the screen violently after receiving only a single shot. Although there is a drawback. There's no respawns. It's game over, and you got to leave your Zen at the door.
Wow. So it's basically you die.
Permadeath.
Why would you want this? Because if you get this, then you're dead forever. It seems like more of a disadvantage than all the other armors.
Well, it was kind of like when people were playing Jedi originally back in Star Wars Galaxies. You died forever. You couldn't come back.
So, you know what, this might be a good armor for role players when they're role playing, because if once you're dead, you're dead. So it helps the role playing experience quite a bit.
We got a group of people that do that in the fleet. What is it, your Theta Squad, where you do the story content?
It's the permadeath. Yeah, this is helping them out quite a bit. It is now permadeath. And you lose all your Zen, so I guess you got to start over.
Be mandatory for everybody, because you know somebody dies and they don't want to delete their character.
Okay, and then we've got here, of course we need some pets, because all the consoles have come with pets. So we've got the Black Beauty pet, who needs a tribble, not you, if you open this prize up. Lucky players will receive their very own Skin of Evil pet. The pet is non-combat, however, Black Beauty will make groaning and gurgling sounds behind you. Also, this pet will randomly envelop other players as they pass by in the zone, making their tune unusable for an hour. That's going to be pretty fun. So, it seems like that's a little excessive, though, for an hour. I mean, it pissed people off when they had the freezy grenade, right? And that was only for a few seconds.
A bunch of oil slicks around Earth Space Dot.
Yeah, you know what, there might not be so many of them, so I can see, you know what, it only happened to a few people who can't play for an hour, so I guess it won't piss too many people off.
Next we have the Shard of Yar. What this shard does, Murphy, is it brings back past people that have been killed, although they are somebody else. They look the same, but they go by a different name and have a fake mustache. And a rubber nose and black sunglasses. It might have been that first Jim Hadar that you shot, or a bartender on Deep Space Nine.
Oh, I see.
Or how about Denatra as a blanket weaver on Bajor?
Oh, that'd be sweet to see. Oh, do you think they'd do something with the Armic?
He could be your ship's counselor, or even a Magato. What do you think they would do with that?
Oh, maybe come back to lead the Roman Empire. That'd be sweet. This sounds like a pretty cool shard. Then we've got the Natasha-class freighter. It's not to be confused now with the Bajoran flagship, the Tuffly, but this freighter comes with a whopping 2 forward weapon slots, but nothing aft, because, you know, nobody cares about the back. No shields, though. If destroyed, it comes back as a Romulan ship. So that'd be sweet. I guess it's a nice little way to get a free scimitar or something. I think they need to rework the description. Again, this is all work in progress, of course.
Don't you think the Romulans have suffered enough?
Yeah.
They've lost their homeworld.
So the freaking Vulcan... Oh, wait, that universe isn't real. All right, we'll move on.
What's a JJ?
What's JJ? Yeah, right. So what do we got next here? Tell us about this Yar Liberty Pass.
Lucky recipients of this pass will receive one hypo of Android Viagra, of can of hair grease, and a crappy dress, and even 30-minute reservation in a holosuite with your favorite Android crew member. And you also get the accolade Never Happened.
Well, at least that's a new accolade. You know, the major problem I'm having with this is now they're doing new accolades through the lockbox. Come on. It's like the DOS. But is it weird to you that they're putting, like, Android Viagra in a lockbox? I mean, does that fit with the T-rated thing on the game?
You know, what gets me is what's an Android knee with hair grease?
Yeah. You know what? This one was kind of weird. I guess either they're taking this out of the lockbox or something's up here.
It goes back to that, what's God do with the starship?
Yeah.
It's like they're just pulling other crap out of their backside.
Yeah. All right, well, we still got a few more here. Let's hit them real quick. The Yar Respect token, what a bonus. Any character up to level 30 can use this token for a complete makeover, Tasha style. Before level 31, your captain will die and leave the game, period. Your crew will hold a crappy 5-minute funeral for your stupid ass. Clean out your stuff and move along. Player's tomb will reappear as a pissed off Romulan once that faction is released in March 2026. Okay.
I thought it was already released.
Yeah, that's confusing me now.
Or is that when they're getting their own star bases, complete design? Well,
I guess maybe they don't consider they're done. Maybe they're not done in their opinion. Because people do argue it's a half faction. I don't know about that, but maybe this dev thought so. But that is weird, because, you know, I never seen them swear in their press states here. This is kind of weird. But we got one more here. Let's hit it real quick.
All right, the last thing that we got here, Murphy, is the Tasha Yar costume pack. Players can choose between a yellow Starfleet security uniform or a much blander, much more asexual version of it.
Oh, okay. All right.
What's also unlocked is a blob tattoo, reminiscent of the burn marks on Yar's face when she got owned by the oil man. The oil slick, if you remember that episode.
That was a good episode. But so what's this here? As always, players will receive something for their troubles, like an engine battery, dead tribble, or a Mark 6 phaser array. All right. Also, with every box unlocked, players won't have the chance in hell to receive a Jem'Hadar attack ship. Well, so what are you waiting for? Let's get buying those keys today. Oh, so this must be their press... This is weird. Like, are you believing this?
I don't think so. It sounds like crap, because who would want a asexual uniform or a blob tattoo? I don't even know
that. Yeah, that doesn't seem like... Hold on, let me look at the email.
Does that mean you reproduce with yourself?
What's going on here? Like, I'm sorry, this is the weirdest leak of information from Cryptic ever. Like, I don't even know if it is from Cryptic. Let me check the email again. It was lockboxdev@trollololol.org. That sounds pretty reliable.
I think it was WeeWee.
You don't think it's reliable? I mean, if it's coming from an organization, it sounds pretty reliable to me. So yeah, that's this lockbox, I guess.
As cool as it sounded, I think most of this is crap. I wouldn't spend too much time on it.
You know what? I gave the Elachi lockbox some crap, but if this is really a true lockbox and we weren't trolled, I'm pretty sure that this would be worse. But, you know, Cryptic might change their plans if this is actually an official release leak for us. I mean, I could see them doing a Tasha Yar lockbox, but maybe not. I don't know.
At this point, I prefer the Bajoran lockbox.
Agreed. Maybe we should, you know what? Maybe we should, like, make up a Bajoran lockbox and, like, pretend to make, like, a fake press release about it. That'd be funny, wouldn't it?
Sure.
Yeah, we should do that. Not, it's not
it,
like we have
to. It gives you a Doth mission to be Kai for a day.
Oh, dude, that'd be sweet. Okay, we'll work on that. I'll just cut this out of the recording, and then that'll be cool. So here, we'll just close the show now. So thank you guys for tuning into Lockbox Files. Thanks for joining us. In all honesty, we don't know what the next lockbox is. So if you actually did are upset, you got trolled. My bad. But Mystic, you had anything to say before we head out?
Not really, but we'll see you in 3.5 months.
Yeah, I guess that's when the next lockbox will be. I'm gonna go with Voth. I think they're gonna do it right as season 8 or 9 or whatever they're calling it hits.
Yeah, it kind of makes sense. Or since the Voth will come out probably sometime after this lockbox, they could do one before the Voth, but I think Voth will happen.
Yeah. Gecko likes the Voth way too much, so I'm pretty sure anything Voth, he'll do it.
And I don't care what you guys. I thought the Voth were cool in Voyager.
Oh, dude, Voth are lame. Come on, man.
I want that city ship.
All right, well, we will catch you guys next week. But no, the Voth are pretty lame, dude.
Next week.
Oh. That's all.
What this does...
found a character, though, on pickup. I see that here. Don't want to miss that.
Yeah. Well, everything will be bound to character, won't you?
I guess so. But I guess that means then you can't trade it, so this will be something you will have to open the box for. But what does it do?
What the hell are we rambling? You gotta edit all that out.